great to be with you on this awesome summer Sunday morning. If we've never met before, my name is Josh, and it is a great joy to stand before you in the presence of God and with an open Bible. So open your Bible with me to 1 Peter chapter 3. 1 Peter chapter 3, we're in the midst of a series called Living Hope. There is a logic and sequence in 1 Peter that I keep coming back to like a broken record. And if this sounds familiar or even annoying because we've said it so many times, there is a great reason to say this over and over again. This is how Peter lays out his content. This is what God has done for you in Christ. It always starts there. Good news, the gospel. This is what God has done for you on your behalf, for your benefit. This is what God has done that you could never do for yourself in your own power or wisdom. This is the grace that fuels your life and rescues you and liberates you. This is what God has done in Christ. And then it moves from what God has done to this is who you are. Your identity, clarifying who you are as a son or a daughter of God who has been purchased by the blood of Jesus himself. And then it moves from the gospel to identity to mission, purpose, ethics, behavior. This is how you should live. This is how you should live. So just so you know, we have officially entered the this is how you should live section of 1 Peter. Whenever you tell somebody how they should live, it can get kind of dicey. It can feel direct, maybe even controlling. But here, Peter is doing us a favor because following Jesus in a fractured world is a complicated thing. We need guidance. We need someone to tell us how to live as we are, as foreigners and exiles, as a strange and peculiar people on planet Earth, as people whose citizenship is already in heaven, who play by different rules, whose heart turn for different reasons, who worship the one true God, who reveals himself perfectly and powerfully in the person and work of Jesus Christ. How shall we live with this citizenship in heaven before we actually get to heaven? And our text for today in 1 Peter chapter 3, verses 1 to 7, Peter teaches us about marriage. He speaks directly to wives and then to husbands. He does not address married couples. He says, wives, I have a word for you. Husbands, I have a word for you. I'm not sure who's challenged or convicted more. I'll let you make your own decision about that. But he speaks directly to both husbands and wives. So before I read this, let me remind you of something that I hope you already know. It goes like this. The hard calling that God has for you is preceded by God's gracious posture toward you. So the hard things God calls you to do, the challenging and courageous decisions the Lord summons from you is preceded by his extravagant grace poured out for you. Our text is 1 Peter chapter 3. It begins like this. Wives, in the same way, submit to your husbands, so that if any of them do not believe the word, they may be won over without words by the behavior of their wives when they see the purity and reverence of your lives. Your beauty should not come from outward adornment, such as elaborate hairstyles and the wearing of gold jewelry or fine clothes. Rather, it should be that of your inner self, the unfading beauty of a gentle and quiet spirit, which is of great worth in God's sight. Now, some of you men are like, praying for me right now. After I read that, how's he going to handle that? Well, I have a plan. I'm not saying it's going to work, but I have a plan. Verse 1 begins with, in the same way. So you have to know, if he's saying, it's kind of like in a conversation, hey, like I was saying a minute ago. He's continuing a previous theme from earlier. It's like saying likewise. And the theme is submission. Submission. He's already called his readers to embrace a submissive posture toward authorities in their government, in their workplace. Peter says that submission is a trademark of all Jesus-honoring relationships. It's not just for wives and husbands. It's for every Christian in every relationship. He says that wives should submit to their husband's leadership in their marriage. This idea is confusing and even offensive to many people in our culture, so I want to pause just for a minute and explain what Peter is encouraging here. When you submit to somebody else, that does not mean that you are inferior or less valuable than they are. Would you agree with that? So this has nothing, absolutely nothing to do with dignity or worth. The command for wives to submit to their husbands should never, ever be taken to imply inferior personhood or spirituality or lesser importance. Nothing could be further from the truth. Peter affirms the opposite. In the life of Jesus affirms the opposite. It could be said that submission is the hallmark of every great marriage. Show me a marriage where there is no submission and it won't be much of a relationship. There'll be very little closeness and joy, intimacy. It'll feel more like an arrangement than a marriage. In Ephesians 5:21, Paul the Apostle says that husbands and wives should submit to each other out of their common submission to Jesus. Mutual submission, two people, loving and deferring for the other and sacrificing for each other is the bedrock of marriage. But Peter here is talking specifically to wives. The word he uses for submission, and let me just say this to impress you, hapotasso. There, I said it. It always implies a submissive relationship to an authority. It is used elsewhere in the New Testament. Let me just tell you how. To talk about submission of Jesus to his parents, of demons being subject to disciples, citizens being subject to the governing authorities, of unseen spiritual powers being subject to Christ, and of Jesus being subject to God the Father. All the same word, same idea. Same word is used of church members being subject to church leaders, and now wives being subject to their husbands. Here's the thing. None of these relationships ever get reversed. And this is good news. This is not a word of oppression. This is not a word of bondage. This is a good, wise, timely word. The classic text on marriage is Ephesians 5, verses 21 to 33. I would encourage you to have it alongside this passage in your own personal time. Paul says that wives should submit to their own husbands the way the church submits to Jesus, and that husbands should love their wives as Jesus loves the church. Marriage is an analogy for the relationship that Jesus has with his people. That relationship can never be reversed. Jesus will never submit to the church, and the church can never provide for and protect Jesus the way he provides for and protects his church. It's countercultural, it's controversial, but it's God's plan for us and for our flourishing. If you're a wife, I want to encourage you to ponder what Peter is teaching you here. Read the first few verses of chapter 3 with an open heart and let God speak to you about the way you approach your husband and the way you view beauty. If we had more time, we would say more about that. I'd probably bring a bunch of women up here and let them talk about that. I'm especially sensitive about the beauty comments in 1 Peter because I have three daughters. And I see the insanity of our culture in a way that I've never seen it before in these days as my daughters grow up. But we have more to talk about. Verse 7, Peter talks to husbands. He says, "Husbands, in the same way, be considerate as you live with your wives. Treat them with respect as the weaker partner and as heirs with you of the gracious gift of life, so that nothing will hinder your prayers." In the same way, shows back up again. He says, in the same way, be considerate. Husbands, be considerate. Don't think about yourself or your interests. Consider your wife. Be aware of them. See them. Observe their desires and frustrations. Notice their needs and weaknesses. Be considerate and attentive to your wife. Treat them with respect and dignity. They're joint heirs of God's grace. They're equally valuable to God. Even though husbands bear the burden of leadership in the home, wives are equally valued and loved by God. And the last verse is absolutely sobering. Peter says that if husbands fail to love their wives well, we can expect our prayers to be hindered. So that your prayers will not be hindered. There's a link between how we husbands treat our wives and the way God responds to our prayers. It's right here. He doesn't amplify on this. He just drops this grenade, pulls the pin, and moves on. But it should send a shockwave into the soul of every husband in this room, including me. I'm really excited about what we're going to do now. Rather than you guys hear me keep on talking and lecturing about this text, I thought it would be perhaps more encouraging and enlightening and disarming and helpful if we had a couple come up and talk about what 1 Peter 3, 1-7 looks like in marriage. And so this couple needs no introduction, but I feel like I need to tell you a little bit about them. It's Tony and Kathy Dupree. Tony and Kathy have been married 49 years. Tony is an elder in the church, a super gifted Bible teacher. If Harpeth had a pope, it would be Tony, without question. Kathy is sharp and steady and wise, and she's just awesome. We're in home group together, and I just can't imagine my life or my family, and I cannot imagine Harpeth Christian Church without Tony and Kathy Dupree. So would you guys help me welcome them to the stage? Hey, Tony and Kathy.
Hello, hey, Josh.
How you guys feeling about this so far?
Well, I know about me. it's a little disconcerting. You sit up here and you're talking about marriage, and I want to have a few disclaimers. We're certainly not have the perfect marriage, you know, Josh. We have. We've made a lot of mistakes in our life, wouldn't you agree, Kathy?
Oh, yes, and this may be another one.
Hey, the jury's out on this, okay? This is kind of a test. I'll tell you what, and another disclaimer, we are not marriage counselors, so we're not trained in any of this other than the training of life. I'm sure you've been familiar with the, you must have all seen the Farmers Insurance commercial, the new one, and it says, "We know a thing or two because we've seen a thing or two." Okay. That's kind of our life experience. Third disclaimer is really just about me. I am, for those of you who know me in our marriage, I'm pretty spoiled. Josh had asked me to just share this. I've said this to a few of our friends before, but about a month ago, we were just talking as we're getting older. And I mentioned, I said, "You know, Kathy, maybe someday I'll have to go into assisted living." And she looked at me and said, "You've been in assisted living for 50 years. And you know, I really didn't have an answer for that. But anyway, there we are. And I would just say this, marriage is complex. We can't cover it. We're just going to be at 10,000 feet here. so many issues and all that. So I want to make everyone just feel that there may be some things that, you know, sometimes life's more complicated than we can let it out to be. But there's some principles here I hope we can cover. So.
And that's why we love you guys right there. You're hilarious and you're humble. So before we get into some marriage stuff, just give us a brief sketch of how you became followers of Jesus.
You know, I think, Kathy, why don't you start? Because her story bleeds into my story, and it bleeds into this text, actually, this morning. So, Kathy, why don't you start?
Okay, and I, too, a little bit uncomfortable up here. My heart rate, Fitbit says it's a little high, so that's okay. Our story begins, almost 50 years ago. We were married young. Tony was 21. I was 20, and I'll help you with the math. I am going to be 70 this year.
Yeah.
Yeah. But we moved to Tennessee from Michigan in about the 11th or 12th year of our marriage. And Tony was really advancing in his career. He was moving up the corporate ladder. And we had three little children. Twins were five. Youngest was four. And life had not, it didn't turn out like I thought it was going to be. It was hard. I had developed a lot of anger, a lot of resentment, perfectionism. I was trying to be Martha Stewart, and it wasn't working very well. At one point, someone in the neighborhood invited me to a baby shower, and I went. I was very lonely, and when I got to the baby shower, the people there were, like, so nice. And I thought, what's with these women? There's something different about them, but I really did not know what it was. And 2 weeks later, this woman invited me to a Bible study. And I was like, whoa, I don't think I want to do that. I grew up in church up until the day we got married, and I said I wasn't going ever again. Some of you have been there. But, you know, I was there Sunday morning, Sunday night, Wednesday night. And I really did not want to go to this Bible study, but they said they had good coffee, and that was a draw, and so I went. But before that, I said to Tony, because I figured he would say, don't go. You know, it's like, why would you go to a Bible study? And he said...
So, you know, I'm a kind of sensitive guy, you know that. So I said, can't hurt.
Well,
that's kind of where we were.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, we were really going different directions at 90 miles an hour. And remember, I had that anger problem. Well, that really made me mad. It was like, okay, I'm going. So I went to the Bible study, and we were studying 1 John about how God loves us. And I understood, you know, that Jesus died for the sins of the whole world. I got that part. But I never understood until that Bible study that my sin of anger, resentment, all those things that I was dealing with, those sins put Jesus on the cross. And I was absolutely broken. In going through those lessons, I came to Jesus, asked him to take over my life. I was born again. I was a new creation, a follower of Jesus. And, you know, Tony wanted me to go to this Bible study. So I thought, well, I'll just do my lessons out loud. He needs to know this, too.
It's very annoying.
Yeah, it was very annoying. But this was a huge turning point in our family. We're just not the same people we used to be.
That's right. Yeah, I mentioned... Kathy's story really ties into this, particularly verse 1 of 1 Peter 3. It says, wives, in the same way, be submissive to your husbands, so that if any of them do not believe the word, that was me, they may be won over without words by the behavior of their wives. I was kind of like Kathy. You know, I grew up in a church, but I never really had a personal relationship with Jesus. We're like 12 years into our marriage, and Kathy had these anger issues. You didn't want to cross Kathy Dupree, I will tell you that, in those days. And all of a sudden, she comes home, and we start studying these lessons. And I really wasn't interested in it, but you know what got me? You know, the Bible says that in Christ we're new creatures, a new creation. And that's not just rhetoric. I was fortunate to see that early in my life, as I began my Christian walk, that she really was a different person. I mean, all of a sudden she's gentle and kind, and I'm like, who is this woman I'm living with? You know, it's like, who is this? And actually, it was her behavior, just like it says in here, that softened my heart to say, okay, what's going on here? There's something real. And it was that changed life. So I began to study Scripture, and about a year later, I was baptized into Christ. So to a large extent, I would want to say this, Josh, I was won over without words by the behavior of my wife, just like the text says. So I'm a recipient of the promise of 1 Peter 3:1, though there were a few words. But
I'm sure
there's always
had
a few words. But she came to the Lord. Her transformation just drew me in.
Wow. That's incredible. So I've got some more questions for you. You ready for this?
Okay.
Not that you have a choice. So this text speaks of the different roles in marriage. I think there's a lot of pressure in our culture to say that men and women in the marriage have identical roles and responsibilities. The gender differentiation, it doesn't exist. It's been a myth. It's old-fashioned. So it's a hot potato culture to say this. So Kathy, I would love to hear you talk about what submission has looked like in your marriage.
Okay, and I'll just tell you, I just got a note up here. It says, can you remove your earring? It's bothering the sound. And there goes the outward adornment.
Yeah.
Right there.
You're living it out.
Yeah.
It might be the other earring because it's closer to the mic.
You think? Is it the other one?
I think it is.
I'll do it in a minute. Okay. Well, when we got married, I had no clue about submission. I am very independent. I like to be in control. I have an opinion about probably everything. Submission is very... Someone's laughing back there, but I do. Submission has been very difficult for me. You know, in Proverbs, a couple of times it says, there's a way that seems right to a man. There's a way that is right to a woman.
Yeah, we should clap for that. That was good.
Yeah. It is. Well, Tony and I mostly agree on everything, but once in a while, we don't. And we've had some family experiences where our family members would have an earthquake, and we would be at the epicenter of those earthquakes. And some things were things that they did to themselves, or things happened to them, that, you know, life happened to them, and we had to, like, take them in for a long period of time. And I really did not want to do it. It's a lot of work. But Tony said, no, we need to do this. We need to take them in. And it came out fine. It was a blessing. With the relationship with the ones we've taken in, it's been really great. There's some other things. Like, I can have amazing ideas of things we should do and spend money and things like that. And Tony will say, let me think about that. And, you know, about 2 days later, you go, how long are you really going to think about this? Because that sale might go away. But we are totally blessed when we really submit unto the Lord.
That's pretty cool. I take it that, like, the decision to have a submissive posture in your marriage, it wasn't like a one-time decision. It was something that was ongoing.
Oh, it's ongoing. We had a submission issue this morning of which side of the church to sit on.
Oh, wow.
He won.
Oh, he did.
Wow. That's right.
Let me ask you this, Kathy. The word submit has all kinds of, it just triggers people. Mm-hmm. And have all these weird negative connotations. But you can, go ahead. If they're going to keep that note up there on the thing, we're going to take it off. I think they really want you to take that earring off. There we go. All right. So,
okay,
congratulations.
All right.
Submission, how has it been a blessing? How have you seen God's goodness and God's wisdom in submission?
Well, it really is God's way of protection. God never asks us to do anything that is not ultimately for our benefit. He never calls us to do anything that is sin. If we ignore God's plan, we just hurt ourselves. We're harming ourselves. And I am very comforted to know that I am under God's protection. I'm under Tony's umbrella of protection. There's freedom in that. There's peace. I don't know. It's the way it should be.
It's really good. So let me ask you one more question, Kathy. We could just let this into Kathy the whole time. But Tony, you have a lot to say, I know. What would you advise the ladies here, especially those who may be pushing back on the idea of submission to husbands?
Well, it's a command. It says submit to your husbands. We're really submitting to Jesus. We're trusting and following him that he's going to take care of us. He's going to protect us. He's going to lead us. Philippians 2 is one of my favorite chapters in the Bible. And actually, the whole book of Philippians is my favorite book in the Bible. And whenever I get off track, I go back and read that book because it really shows me how I should live. Your husband and your family should be the number one benefactors of your love. Attitude is so important. That's a choice that we make. And a wise woman told me many, many years ago, she said, what's in the well comes up in the bucket. And if you are harboring resentment, anger, jealousy, whatever it is, that's going to come up in your dipper, if that's what's in your heart. Mm-hmm. So attitude is very important.
That's really good. Really, really wise, worth pondering. So Tony, let me ask you a question. Okay. How has your connection with Jesus affected how you see and treat Kathy?
Well, good question. And I've thought of a few things. One, you know, when I first became a believer, and it really changed in our marriage, the first thing, I started reading the Bible, and, you know, I've kind of become a Bible student my whole life. And I began to take my role as a spiritual leader seriously, because the Bible talks about this authority that the husband has. And I've learned, as you mentioned today, there's authority and submission. It's in the military. I had it in business. The whole world is set up that way. But with authority comes responsibility. And I would just say it really changed how I looked at our marriage. And this is something for the guys out here, the husbands. You know, you're primarily responsible, and I am, for the spiritual health of my family. I remember when I first started reading the Bible in Genesis, you know, this all started, I didn't know Galatians from Galatians, you know. I mean, it was like, I didn't know anything about the Bible. And I see, it was interesting to me when Eve ate, well, we always say the apple, but the fruit. So Eve eats the fruit and God goes looking for Adam. And that always struck me. It's like, why is he looking for Adam? I don't want to get Eve off the hook now, but I think the real first sin was that Adam failed to lead and protect his wife and his family. So that's something I just take very seriously, and I would take, and just even as an elder to the church, for husbands, you can't abdicate that authority over to your wife and say, well, that's the wife's thing to take, the spiritual health of my children and you. Because that won't fly. Someday we're going to be facing the Lord, and he's going to call us into account. So that's made a big, big difference in my life. And I guess the one thing that's really, if I could say one thing just that I've learned, that's how do you have a lifelong, this is almost half a century of marriage, and we've had our ups and downs like everybody, but I think the key is a commitment to covenant, to be promise keepers. I read an article years ago, I don't remember exactly what it said, but I remember the title, and it was about marriage, and the title of the article was this, A Promise Spoken and Not Forgotten. That just really hit me. A promise spoken and not forgotten. And it went on to talk about our marriage vows. When it says better or for better or worse, we've all said those words if you're married. They mean just what they say. Sometimes there's some worse times in your marriage. It doesn't mean until you stop meeting my needs or until you know I don't love you anymore. Till death do us part means what it says. It doesn't mean until someone better comes along or something else comes along. And the reason I think covenant that I've just learned over my lifetime is why it's so important is because, see, feelings are just not a good foundation for a lifelong relationship. They're important, but it has to be covenant. It can't be feelings because, see, we're living organs and things that are alive change, and we forget that. I mean, when we first fell in love, I was in a rock band. She was a groupie, you know? Look at us now.
I tried to get a picture of that, and they did not. They said no.
But the point is, you ever hear someone say, I've said it, you probably have heard people say it, well, he's not the person I married, or she's not the person I married. Of course not. I mean, we're changing and morphing all the time. I can't tell you how different we are as people. And I kind of see it like, you know, you get married, you're young, and whether you're married a year or 50, you start off kind of this soulmates, but then life hits and things change, and one person starts growing at a different rate, one person's interests move, and then the kids come, and then the career, and then teenagers, and it just on and on and on. And when Kathy first went to that Bible study, we were like this. Divorce was right there at the door, and God saved us from that. But as we lived another 40 years into this, as we morphed along, I've saw that as we've moved and changed, it's the thing that tethers us and brought us back together again and again was covenant, a promise spoken and not forgotten, and that is so key. It will weave to hearts together. And it's not, I remember talking to a guy once and it was like, so you mean you stick to the one you stuck with? I said, no, that's not exactly what I mean. What I mean is marriage, long-term marriage is a falling and refalling in love, which makes it kind of an adventure because we're different people and we're different stages, but covenant, it is what really holds us together, and that is key to me. If I could say one thing to the church and to husbands and wives, promise keepers is totally changed my lives. That's why we're here today, married.
Praise God. Thank you, Tony. Kathy, what would you add to that? Do you have any advice for wives?
Well, we really need to find out what pleases our husbands. And little things matter a lot. Just do the next right thing. You know what those things are. Spend time together. Take weekends away without the children. Go out for dinner without the kids. I see families so caught up in their kids that by the time the kids get to like 18 and leave for college or go on to do something else, they don't even know each other. And it's very, very important to keep your relationship up, keep that communication going well. So have a date this week.
There you go. I like that. Yeah. Now, Tony, I want to address that last verse. It seems to indicate that a husband's connection with God and our treatment of our wives are related to each other. So I would love for you to just ruminate and exhort us as husbands with verse 7.
Okay. We don't have time to really go through deep exegesis of this text. But it begins with husbands. You know, and you mentioned when you talk about how God, I find it interesting, doesn't really talk, when he talks about behavior in a marriage, he doesn't sit the couple down. He says, wives, I'm talking to you. Husbands, I'm talking to you. And we need to be listening and obeying whatever God tells us to do. My obedience to what God tells me to do, like in this verse, is totally independent of whether Kathy's submitting or not. And her submission is not dependent on whether I'm loving her as Christ loved the church. Sometimes I'm not very loving, but she still has a responsibility. Sometimes she doesn't submit so well. Sometimes maybe her role gets off track. I still have to love her. You know, I want to tell you, a death to a marriage, I'm going to say, well, I'll do my part. I'll love you, but if you were like that, I would do that. And, well, I'd submit to you, husband, if you loved me like that. And we just got to get away from that. So he talks now, this is to the husbands. He says, in the same way, be considerate as you live with your wives. And just a quick word on that. The text literally says this, dwell with your wife according to knowledge, understanding. And it's not talking about live with them, you have the same address. It's about we need to understand our wives' goals, frustrations. What is she afraid of? What brings her fear? What brings her joy? And that's a light, you know, guys, you need to understand your wife. This is a lifelong project. I'll give you an example. Now, I've known Kathy 50 years, and I just thought of this the other day. A year ago, we're watching the Predators and the Penguins Stanley Cup playoff. Sidney Crosby is a star, for those of you who don't know, star hockey player for the Penguins. And we're watching, and the commentator just says something. So I've known this woman for 50 years. Something about Sidney Crosby. And she just, as calm as can be, turns to me and says, I have his rookie card. You have what? It's like, you think you know a woman, you know? She has a little stack of NHL hockey cards. I don't have much, but I would have bet everything I had on that one. That was just like, do you think you know somebody?
I don't even know you anymore.
I made her show it to me. I had a little sticky note, and the sticky note on Crosby's thing was, he's going to be great someday.
Wow. So she's also a prophet.
Think you know somebody. So I don't do too well at that anyway. But I could learn.
Well, I'm going to tell a little story about something Tony did very well. Life has not always been easy for us. We've had ups and downs, we've had victories, we've had joys, but we've gone through things together. And we had been married about 20 years, and my mom came to live with us, and she had struggled with depression and health issues most of her life. But she came to live with us, and we were consumed by her. We had three teenagers, and after about 6 months with us, she decided to overdose on antidepressants and took her own life, and it was very, very difficult. And I had to be so strong for the family, just keeping everybody together, and the day of her funeral, I went in to get dressed, and finding clothes has never been a problem for me, but that day, I could not even pick out an outfit. And Tony came in, and he said, wear this, I know you look nice in it. And that was huge for me.
You know, what's interesting about that story, I don't even remember it. A lot of things I don't remember, but I don't remember that. But I would just say this, that it was really, it's interesting, and speak to husbands and wives, but particularly to the wives, husbands, your wife will remember those little things, even though if you don't. And it's amazing to me how important that was to Kathy, that I knew her enough to know what she would be comfortable in, and as the day went on, was appropriate. The text, just quickly as we end here, it talks about treating your wife with respect as the weaker partner. We could spend a lot of time on that verse, but it really talks about, at the heart of it, is to care and cherish for your wife as something of great value. That's what he's talking about. And then about how we are going to be co-heirs. You see that we all have roles to play in our lives. In a marriage, we have roles to play. But what Peter's reminding us and what the Bible says again and again, in terms of value and worth before God, we're in this together. We're partners. Marriage is not we're not competitors. Our goal is to help each other trust and follow Jesus as best we can. And I know, just my last thought of this is, much of what we're talking about today is so contrary, it's so politically incorrect to our culture and to the secular world we live in, but after 50 years, because I know a thing or two, because I've seen a thing or two, I just want to end with this. God's ways work because he made us and he established marriage. And if we follow his plan with all of our flaws and warts, God will bless it.
Amen, brother. Amen. Kathy, I want to give you the last word.
That's usual. Yeah.
So I'm imagining, now I'm just imagining, I could be way off track here, wouldn't be the first time, that there might be a couple or two or three or five that listen to your five decades. And even with the hard things you've walked through, and thank you for your vulnerability and sharing that about your mother in that tender moment. What would you say to a couple who feels intimidated, overwhelmed, and defeated in their marriage?
You absolutely cannot do this on your own. And as Christians, we have the Holy Spirit to hold us up through difficulties, through good times, through bad times. Holy Spirit teaches us, convicts us, convinces us. He strengthens us. He gives us victory. And that's true whether you're married or single. And I hope today that you will choose to take a step closer to Jesus. You cannot change the past, but you can be free from it. I pray that you get help. You cannot do this alone. And as this church, it says on the back, we're helping people trust and follow Jesus. Pray for a mentor. Find somebody who will walk alongside you, who will help you. Dig deep into God's word. Offer forgiveness. Take that step. And pray for one another. The choice is yours. And I really hope that you'll make that choice today.
Would you guys join me in thanking the Duprees for their testimony? If you're in a hard place, and you just need to sit and have a more private moment with God, you can absolutely do that. There's no rules, no boxes to fit in right now. And if you're single and you're like, what just happened? This was a teaching on marriage. First of all, I'm really glad you're here. And the principles that govern a Christ-exalting marriage govern every relationship. And the principles are transferable. And I'm sure you already see that. So just ask God to help you navigate your own life circumstances and trust that he'll be faithful. So let's take communion together and we'll worship some more. Lord Jesus, thank you for speaking to us so powerfully and clearly through Kathy and through Tony and through 1 Peter 3:1-7. Help us to submit to your wisdom. Help us to cast away every voice that contradicts your wisdom. And help us to ruthlessly trust in you. As we take communion, Jesus, we fix our eyes on you. Help us, Lord Jesus. Give us strength and wisdom and hope and grace.